네.
Starting the church in Thessalonica was not easy. Okay, first of all, we read in Acts chapter 16 that Paul first came to Philippi, and there he was illegally whipped by the magistrate just by bringing the gospel to that city. And that's why he calls it suffering and shameful treatment in verse 2. And then after Philippi, Paul comes to Thessalonica, and there he faces all kinds of criticism, he faces legal action, so much so that he incited a riot and people were running him out of town, so he had to leave fast. But not before he saw several people come to faith in Jesus Christ. And those people came together and started a church, the Church of the Thessalonians. It's a toss-up. A toss-up is a situation in which every possible outcome is equally possible. And Paul has found himself in this kind of situation before. Many of the churches that he started found themselves in this same sort of fork in the road situation where they had the choice to continue following Jesus or to veer off that path and go a different way. And every single time, Paul addresses the issue of the toss-up in the same way. Okay, here's what he says in Philippians chapter 2. He said, "Hold fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain." And then to the Corinthians, he said this, "Hold fast to the word that I preached to you, unless you believed in vain." And then remember what he said to those knuckleheads, the Galatians? He said this, "I am afraid that I have labored over you in vain." Every time Paul consistently uses this same phrase, in vain, when he is talking to a church that is on the fence. Now notice down at verse 1, look again. "For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain." Check that out. Paul uses that same phrase, but this time we know that the Thessalonians made it out all right. They kept following Jesus. They stayed faithful. Now, you and I find ourselves in the middle of an off season where things are very much up in the air. How long will it last? Nobody seems to know for sure. It really is a toss-up. You know, on the one hand, maybe this is all for the better. Maybe we'll all learn great lessons along the way and we'll bond with each other and we'll unite in love and we'll innovate new creative ways of doing business and make tons of friends. Maybe. But isn't it just as likely that we could come out the other end of this pandemic more fragmented, more polarized, and more anxious than ever before? See, no one knows what the long-term effects of this season will be. It could go either way. Now, let me ask you a question. In your personal life, have you ever found yourself in the middle of a toss-up? Yeah, I have. Really? When was that, Spencer, my alter ego? How about right now? Right now? You mean like right now, right now? You want to play me? Yeah, right here, right now. You, me, you. One-on-one. Let's play. Let's see who comes out on top. Game on. Why are you saying that? I've always wondered, why do basketball players say that? I don't know. Oh, the floor was slick. Someone spilt their blue blast.
Yeah, right.
Your ball. Come on. Is that all you got? What's going on? Now, this outcome for the Thessalonians was by no means certain. It was truly a toss-up. So we need to ask, what was the key to their success? We need to see something really important in the passage for just a second. Paul says this in verse 2. He's talking about his treatment at Philippi, and he calls it suffering. And then he also calls it shameful treatment. Okay, this is the context of the story, that Paul was in the midst of an intense conflict. That's the story. In fact, at the end of verse 2, he calls it much conflict. Okay, and it's in the midst of all of this conflict, all of this stuff going on, that Paul makes a contrast. At the very beginning in verse 1, he says this, but through. In other words, even though all this was going on, in the middle of it all, through it all, he says, we had boldness. We had boldness. Now, this word boldness literally means free speech or unmitigated freedom to speak what needed to be said. In other words, Paul can just not help himself. He's doing what he needs to do. He has the absolute confidence to move forward no matter what happens. Now, what is the key here? How can we have that same kind of confidence? Well, notice how Paul puts it. He says, boldness in God. Boldness in God. Now, this is the key. When you find your confidence in God and in God alone, nobody can shake you up. Nobody can take that confidence from you. Now, practically, what did this look like? Well, he goes on to say, boldness in God to declare the gospel of God, meaning the message of God. He had freedom of speech to say what needed to be said because this message was from God. Which all leads me to say this. Look, conflict can really rock our confidence. But when you have the gospel, the message of God, you can have confidence to say what you need to say and make all the right decisions that need to be made in the midst of conflict. Hey, what are you doing? I've scored like 10 points on the court waiting for you. How? That's literally not possible. The ball was in my possession. Oh, well, you and I look a lot alike, so the ref couldn't even tell the difference. Don't worry about it. Look, things get really complicated when it involves other people. Sun to my eyes. Oh, I just ate. Stomach cramps. Run it. Motion. Come on, ref. You see that? Oh. That was a total flop.
At the time of Paul, traveling philosophers were something of a nuisance. Okay, a traveling philosopher would show up at a Roman city, peddling some new religion or some Greek philosophy, trying to gain followers who would pay him a monthly subscription. And these guys were basically the first century equivalent to Amway, or maybe the first century equivalent to those guys in the middle of the mall that try to sell you remote control helicopters. No offense, if that's your job, I'm sure you're a meaningful contributor to society. But see, Paul was different, okay? Paul boldly declared God's message. And it was not a scheme to make money or get famous. Now check it out, verse 3, he says, our appeal, that is our message to people, does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive. He's making clear that what he is preaching is not a mistake, it's not from bad motives, and it's not trying to deceive people into following him. And then later in verse 5, he says this, for we never came with words of flattery, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed. God is witness. Nor did we seek glory from people, whether from you or from others. Here's the point that Paul is making. His message was not to make people happy, not to gain a following, not to turn a profit. No, Paul was concerned about one person's opinion and one person only, and that was God. In a toss-up like the one we're in right now, one of the ways that we can be sure that we turn away from Jesus is if we start to live for other people's opinions.
I don't care what anyone thinks about me.
Really, you don't? You don't care what anyone thinks of you?
Yeah, I was just talking to my girlfriend about this. She totally agrees, so.
Okay, you kind of just proved my point. Well, anyway, speaking of seeking others' opinions, let's seek the opinion of my friend, Dr. Greg Jantz. He's an expert in this, a psychologist, nationally renowned, and he has a lot to say on this matter. How you doing, Dr. Jantz?
Hi, Pastor Riley.
Do you feel like you're on Sesame Street right now?
I do, wearing my mask, yes.
Hey, nice. So I had a question. It seems to me that in a time of fear and anxiety like we're in, we tend to be afraid not just of the disease, but also of people. There's an added social pressure. So could you explain to us a little bit of some of the reasons psychologically that we kind of become afraid in times like these?
Yes, one of the things that quarantine can do, Pastor Riley, is it causes us to create some self-doubt. You know, fear is paralyzing. And from a spiritual sense, you know, fear is the great paralyzer that keeps us from growing and doing things. So one of the things that happens is we get a lot of self-doubt. Hmm. The more we're cooped up, the more doubt we become. And then when we start to venture out, we feel afraid as well. And we wonder, wow, how do I treat people? How will people treat me? Everything seems awkward and therefore a lot of self-doubt.
Does that self-doubt come from things being uncertain and like we're not used to the situation, so we start to doubt everything in us and outside of us?
I think that we've kind of had a ticking time bomb going on here. We've had uncertainty with fear, and those two together, we don't know what the future holds. And so in a social sense, we have to learn to readapt.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much, Dr. Jan. So good to see you guys. Look, seeking the wise counsel of friends, family, or trusted authorities is not a bad thing. But we have to be careful because we are living in a moment of fear and anxiety. And it's not just about the virus or catching something. It's also about being afraid of what others think of us. It's about the social pressure and the shame and the judgment that comes from people all around us. And oftentimes we can put way too much stock in what people say and what they think and their worldview and what they are saying about us. And we're trying to please people. But that is not a strong foundation on which to build your life. People's opinions change. People's thoughts fluctuate. And pretty soon, if that's how you're building your life, you will find your entire being shaken to the core. No, followers of Jesus have a far better foundation on which to build our lives. Okay, look again at verse 4. See what Paul says about this. He says, just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not to please man, but to please God, who tests our hearts. See, Paul's sense of approval, of validation, of self-worth and value as a human being, not to mention his calling, his task to preach the gospel in the
name of Jesus, all of that comes not from anyone else, but only from God. And because of that, he's been freed up from the opinions of others. I love what he says in verse 4 when he says, "We speak not to please man, but to please God." You know, it's a choice. It's a toss-up. It's either way. You can either live to please God, or you will live to please man. Who will you live to please? You will try to live to please somebody. Will it be God or will it be others? You know, some of us are living to please our neighbors. We want to look great. Now, part of that's fine, but there's a line there where we can be enslaved to it. Some of us are living enslaved to the opinions of our family. Others are living just so wrapped up in the opinions of our friends that we don't even know who we truly are as individuals. But see, when we are committed to the gospel, that is the message of Jesus, we are freed up. We no longer are tethered and enslaved to the opinions of others, but now we are living for God and we know where we stand with him. I love how Paul says, "I am approved by God." That word approved means tested or examined. It has the idea of God stating who Paul is, what he's all about, and his value as a servant of God. It's known. It's set. There's no changing it. Paul says, "I am approved by God." See, when you live for the opinions of others, that approval shifts with time. It shifts with trends. It shifts with the winds of change. But God's opinion never changes because it's built on what Jesus has done. Jesus shed his precious blood to show us how valuable we are to him. That's God's opinion. Are you living for that or are you living for others? Now, this section on the toss-up culminates in a brilliant vision of the kind of community Jesus wants for you and me. If we're gonna live through a toss-up like the one we're in, where things could go either way, and stay committed to Jesus Christ, we need gospel confidence, like we talked about. We need to live to please God and not to please people. But thirdly, we need a vision of the kind of community Jesus wants for us. I love how Paul ends it in verse 8, where he says, "When we came to you, we wanted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves." See, this is a beautiful vision of the kind of community that will make it through this toss-up faithful to Jesus. If we don't just talk, if we don't just share the news, the message, the teachings, the videos, if we don't just talk about the Bible and the way of Jesus, but we actually share life together, this is how we make it through. See, it's so tempting right now to just use social distancing as an excuse to remain in isolation, to grow in our distrust of others rather than practice trust, practice giving, practice sacrificial love. No, to instead remain in our houses, clam up, hold fast to everything that we have and practice surviving rather than what Jesus practiced, which was giving. So I get it. I understand why many of us may not be quick to trust others. You know, maybe you grew up with parents that you couldn't trust who weren't there for you. Maybe in your life you have had friends stab you in the back, betray you, or abandon you. Maybe you've been burned by the church. Maybe in your work environment, people are really not to be trusted. Maybe this is just your view of the world, that people are not trustworthy at all. I get it. But listen, the gospel changes things. The good news of Jesus changes things. You know, Jesus himself practiced this. In John chapter 15, he said this, "This is my commandment, love each other. In the same way I have loved you, there is no greater love than to lay one's life down for his friends." There's no greater love than to love each other that way. And you know what? That is exactly what Jesus did. When Jesus came to live, he did not come just to teach cool concepts, abstract principles, advice for better life. No, Jesus came to give his life, to lay it all down. Why? To make a people, to show his love and to build this treasured possession, this holy nation, this people called the church, the family of God. So if you're watching this and you're part of a church, I want to encourage you, join a small group, call up friends, build that kind of community, make those connections so that you are not living this season alone. We need each other. And likewise, we need Jesus. Paul says to the Thessalonian church, you became very dear to us. And there, Paul is just exemplifying the heart Jesus has for us. We are very dear to him. He desires that closeness, the relationship. He wants to pour out his love. When we go to him in prayer and read his word, when we spend time in fellowship, when we worship, when we give thanks, he wants to fill us to the brim with himself so we can pour out love to others and so that we can be the kind of gospel community that Jesus envisioned. Look, you and I are living in strange times. It is a total toss-up. Things could go either way. But when we have Jesus with us, we know exactly which way they will go. Ready, Spencer?
Let's do this. Sorry I elbowed you in the face. Don't sweat it.
You know, they say the best defense is a good offense. I believe that the best defense is a good offense and that the best offense is a good defense. But I actually believe the best defense is a good offense. And so that when you're out there, you know, we're just trying to give it our all. And, you know, we played hard and they played hard too. And, you know, we're all just playing hard. And so when you go out there, you know, you're trying to win. And we tried to win, but, you know, you can't win them all. But we did win this one. And you can't win them all, but we won. So, you know, we're just trying to give it our all and just playing the game. The coach, daddy. I want to say thank you to my mom. And I want to say thank you to everyone at the academy for the win. And I just appreciate it that we went out there and gave it our all. And we were rewarded with the best. And just trying to give it our all.